Coming up, retrenched workers get help polishing up their resumes and interviewing skills. And, well, the job market these days may be a tough nut to crack, especially if you don't have the right tools. That's what inspired Michael Lum, a professional trainer, to conduct free workshops for retrenched workers on resume writing and what to do at an interview. Cheryl Fox managed to squeeze her way into today's packed session at the YMCA.
The response to the workshop entitled Who Broke My Rice Bowl was overwhelming. Almost 200 people, mainly retrenched workers over the age of 40, came on a similar mission.
Trying to polish up the searching skills and the resume writing skills and those type of things.
I believe with this workshop, we'll be able to even write better and more attractive resume for the employers to see.
Rightly so, after all, an impressive resume is a first step, and then comes a job interview. Trainer Michael Lam says that feedback shows that some retrenched workers failed to get that job because of mistakes made during the interviews.
When you talk to the prospective employee, always look to them in the eyes. Because once your eyes go around darting all over the place, it shows that you're insincere. In the interview, never badmouth the company, or your colleagues, or your boss, because that is what I call an interview suicide.
For the older job seekers, his advice is to use their years of experience as a USP or unique selling point.
The employee has to impress the employer that he has the skills. You know, he has done so much in his previous job and he could be able to contribute in the new company.
Michael plans to organize such free workshops at the YMCA on a monthly basis, and he's also looking for volunteers to help retrenched workers polish up their resumes. More information is available at this website.
Di sebelah kanan saya ialah pengarang buku Berani Gagal, Dare to Fail, Failure Guru Malaysia, Billy Lim. Yeah? Okay, dan juga mendapat julukan Failure Guru Singapura.
Hello.
Okay. Dan juga Stressologist. Kalau siapa stress boleh berpikir ke dia. Saudara Michael Lam. Okay.
Is it true?
What? No such thing as failure. What's success delay?
Yeah, actually, a lot of people don't understand macam like the animals.
Yeah.
They don't know anything about failing.
Okay.
Look at animal when they fall down, they still walk. Dia tak tahu apa adalah kegagalan.
Okay.
It's only human being that knows something as failing, no?
Okay.
But when we are a baby, we also do not know anything about failing.
Okay.
The problem is, where do human being begin to learn about failing?
Okay.
Kalau we analyze carefully, to me lah, I think it's in the school lah. Because in the school, that's where they start now. You pass, you fail. You pass, you fail. 45, you get 45 mark out of 100, you fail.
In America, they say pass, no pass. So they don't say fail.
Oh, no wonder. I think maybe we must change lah. But the funny thing is because if a person get 44 marks, he fail.
Okay.
But because of one more mark, 45, he pass.
Mm.
So where is the line? You know? Is there actually something failure? You know?
I see.
Actually, to me, failing is part of success.
Okay.
That's why today I invite Mr. Michael Lam. He's from Singapore.
Yeah.
He is the failure guru of Singapore who wrote this book that we published.
Okay.
No failure, only success delayed. Maybe you want to ask him a few questions why he thinks so also.
Because he's a stressologist.
You also write about this so that people who fail go and see him.
Okay.
So he can relieve their stress.
Okay, tell us that.
Well, actually, there's no failure. Or you look at a baby.
Okay.
A baby in his oversized pampers, he walked and he fell down. He get up again and he walk and he fell down. He get up again and he walk and he fell down.
Mm-hmm.
So there's no such thing as failure. It's only success delayed.
Mm-hmm.
To the baby, failing is part of the learning process.
Mm-hmm.
He failed, he get up again, he failed, he get up again. But as an adult, we fail once, we give up everything. We fail twice, we give up everything. We fail in one relationship, we remain single for the rest of our life. Yes, exactly. So there is no failure, only success delayed.
Uh-huh.
You see, there's a Japanese proverb that says, if you fall 7 times, you arise 8 times, you are a success.
Mm-hmm.
So the philosophy of life is you just have to get up one more time and you will be a success.
Yeah, but then people will say it depends on the degree of the failure, you know. If you fail teruk, how, you know?
Susah juga.
Actually, Encik Suami, nowadays a bit different. Dulu in the old world, kalau you fail one time, it take you maybe 10, 20 years. No?
Yeah.
Now, because of this new economy, you fail and succeed very fast. No? Very fast. So the speed is it's so fast that the time for you to rise up again is shortened. Yeah. But for you to fall again, it's also very fast. Maybe like, for example, Dato So Chi Weng. Same thing, he rise so fast and he go down now. But he will come back so fast also. Something like that. So people, we have to let people understand that, we keep on going on. One day you will reach success. Very soon reach success. Like for example, like Thomas Edison, One day he was asked, Mr. Thomas Edison, why? How do you feel about failing so many times? So Thomas Edison said, I have not failed. I have invented the electric bulb.
Right.
What I did is I took about 2,000 steps now.
Okay.
To reach my final success. So to him, it's not failure. To him, it's all success, small, until the end, he reached the final result. So we shouldn't take things like whatever we do as a mistake, as a failure. In fact, we should be courageous enough. The person who really failed are the people who daren't do anything, didn't take any action. Then is a real failure. Yeah, anybody.
But how you change the culture? Hey, Singapore,
you see,
like
actually, people look at failure and success as opposite side of the coin.
Yes.
And this is entirely wrong. Actually, failure and success is in one straight road. You have to walk on the road of failure first before you come to success. And success is at the end of the road. See, many people give up, as Thomas Edison said. When they are walking on the road of failure, they give up. When actually the next step is success. So failure and success is not the opposite side of the coin. It is a long road. You have to walk on the road of failure before you come to success. And many people give up on the point where the next step is just success. And the greater the failure, the more lessons you learn. That's why you see people who has arise on failure, they become a totally brand new person, because the experience and the trauma of failure make them into a hardened person.
Yeah, but to come up after that, how do you...
You see, that's why we have been giving this kind of talk, to make people understand what failure is first. For example, I give a more easier example. It's like, we have been eating vitamin, Nowadays, a lot of people eat vitamin. They got vitamin, got time release, Time release one, the vitamin you eat already, slowly you will release it. So actually, we cannot call this as failure. We must say that failure is something like time really success. You say, really, in the end become successful. So it's the same thing that students, people all over the world must be able to perceive that there's no such thing as failure. It's just a process of our life. But if we are so scared and we are so conditioned, if we do something, we fail, we will never be able to achieve anything. Malaysia will never be able to say, Malaysia boleh. Before Malaysia can be boleh, there are many tak boleh. Tak boleh, then jadi boleh. It's like that. We hope that viewers will be able to understand so that sometimes they experience some setback in their life, they don't take it as failure.
Right. Yeah, okay, you're looking at it from a philosophical point of view, but at the end of the day, they will get this grade saying that I pass, you distinction, you credit, you fail. Then how?
No, that's why. That's why we are hoping that now we hope to change the paradigm of society, Because they cannot just, because a student failed in the exam, we say that you're stupid. How can you say like that, Because it's not true. Just because you fail doesn't mean you're stupid. Maybe he can be very successful as a footballer. You can be very successful as a musician. Maybe you failed in some other thing, but not everybody is good in everything. But people can be good in a particular specific thing. Right. So we cannot say that a person failed because just he failed in something. Because nowadays we discovered multiple intelligence, In other words, people have different kind of intelligence. Some are good in, like for you, are very good as a host. Some is very good at writing. Some very good at speaking. Some very good in mathematics. Different. So we must appreciate everybody for their ability to try and do what they want to be.
In Singapore, in Malaysia,
you hit my mind.
Emphasis on failure. Once you fail, you are condemned for the rest of your life. And that's why, as a result, people they're not innovate, people they're not create, people they're not try new businesses, new innovation.
Right.
Now in America, they are very successful. Why? Because Americans accept failure as part of their culture. Look at California, they invented the computer, the windsurfing, the rollerblading, because it's the culture where if you fail, it is perfectly okay. And failing is part of the learning process.
You tell that to the venture capital people?
Yes, exactly. I have presented my book to the government officials, to ambassadors, telling them that failing is actually part of the learning process. Mm. You see, we learn textbooks in school, we learn English, we learn maths in school, but we do not learn failure.
Yeah.
And we have to learn failure the hard way. Mm. We have to learn failure out in the streets, out in the highway and byways of the world. You see, in America, they give a purple heart for courage. Mm,
right.
Okay, when you fight in a war, you wounded yourself in the war, you give a purple heart.
Yeah.
But when you fail, the government actually should give us a purple heart for daring to fail.
Right.
You know, for taking the initiative to venture out and we fail.
Yeah, that's a good
it's
point.
Process.
That's a very good point. Mm. In fact, Swami, you see, like the West and the East, why every time we are following behind the West, you see, like for example, we in the East invent the paper money, but the West go one step further. They dare to do it and they invent the credit card. You know, then we in the West, we invent the kite. In the East, invent the kite. The West invent the aeroplane. Mm. Then we invent the oyster cake. They invent the Pizza Hut. Mm. You know, then we have the our Dr. Mahathir here, and they have George Soros. You know what I mean?
Yeah.
So, DJ, the thing is, we must be able to dare to challenge, dare to break through, and dare to fail in order to go to new limit and new area. Mm. That's why, like what Michael said, there is no lesson about failure. That's why it's very good for the viewers. If they want to know more about failure, they tune in MHI. This is the session where we are trying to share knowledge on failure. You know, become very important. Actually, there is no such thing, actually. Failure and success is only on the opposite side.
Mm.
You cannot have success without failure. A lot of people don't understand this concept.
Okay, let's talk about cooperation, about companies. You advise them too, right?
Yes.
Okay, now, how do you change the mindset of the chief executives, the decision makers in companies?
Actually, the corporate world, they are not failed. That's why we are left behind.
Yeah.
You look at McDonald's, look at Burger King. Mm. See, the American did not invent the burger. The Chinese invented the burger with the Chinese pao.
Mm.
See, the Chinese pao is the originator of hamburger, but the Americans dare to try the different market. Now, another example is look at MTV, they are very successful now, but who's the original MTV? It's in India. India, you have the Indian dance, and they shake and they dance, you know. They originate it. Look at Phantom of the Opera, the Chinese the musicals in London, they didn't originate.
Mm-hmm.
In China, you had the Chinese opera. But the Americans take one step further, they dare to market, they dare to reinvent, they dare to try out again.
Mm.
So look at Nike shoes, they are so big today.
Mm-hmm.
But actually Nike shoes, the origin of basketball shoe is in China, in Japan.
Mm-hmm.
Okay, but see, the Asian culture is too close, dare not fail. That's why there are no global Asian companies.
How to shortcut that? Rather than, we keep on saying this, the Asians would invent all this, and then the West would, change here a little bit, and then they become better. Now, is there a shortcut to change the whole mindset?
The shortcut is that the government has to accept failure, You see, we are branded success or failure. It's a very distinct. You see, if you pass your exam, you're deemed to be a success. If you fail, you are nobody, you're outcast.
Mm-hmm.
So we have to change the whole society, the mindset.
Yes.
The failure is perfectly okay for us.
Okay.
It is a learning process, period.
Yeah, same question to you.
In other words, we need to develop a culture that can tolerate failing.
Mm.
If people fail, we cannot just condemn them or laugh at them.
Uh-huh.
We must be able to honor them for being able to dare to take a challenge, dare to do something new. In fact, if you look at it very carefully, boxing, you can?
Yeah.
Boxing is very funny, you got 15 rounds, You can lose first round until the 14th round. But if the 15th round you win, you are the world champion. You agree, na?
Yeah.
So this is exactly what it's all about. Right? The most important thing is the final goal that the person achieved. No?
Yeah.
You can be a very bad person, and then in the end, you do something great for the world. Everybody blame you, but in the end, you do something great for the world. You are the champion of the world. So that's why people must dare to do it, so that they understand that it's okay. But the worst thing is never to try anything. That is the worst failure. That is a very important thing.
Okay, great. This gentleman can be contacted also.
Yes.
And how do they contact you?
Okay, let me let you know. You see, today I will this week I will begin 5 of this book written by Mike. 5 of this no failure, only success, delay.
Okay.
Given to the best quotation, all the three, and they can SMS to dare to fail, send to this 019-355-5500-06 or they can also email us at daretofail.com and get a free newsletter. Or if they want to contact Michael, you can
lum1128@starhubnet.sg. So anybody who are stressful or what, who know about failure, can contact him directly. So this is the way we try.
Okay, good. I think it's also good that we announce the name of the winner.
Oh, yeah.
I got the name. Okay.
And the very interesting quotation. Yes, that's very good.
Week number one. The winners for Day to Fail books, Encik Muhammad Haizal Abdul Wahab from Quarters Hospital Langkawi, pemenang pertama. We also have Cik Rosnani Binti Muhammad Mu'min, Taman Bukit Teratai, Ampang. So they're winners of Day to Fail book for week number one. And on that week, we had the best slogan. Yeah?
Yes.
It was sent by Encik Zayudin@pc.jaring.my. Okay, this is very interesting. We don't dare to fail because we think no one fails. Mm. They don't tell when they fail. Only upon success do they hail.
This is very good.
I like that. Okay,
this week even better.
Okay, for week two, winners. Yeah, there are four winners altogether. Muhammad Amin Abdul Kadir from Kampung Rawa, Pulau Pinang. We have Muhammad Hasri Hasbullah, Gombak, Kuala Lumpur. Farhaniza Abdul Ghaffar from Simpang Regam, Johor. And also Caroline J from Tambunan, Sabah, Malaysia. Is it Caroline Jackson, my friend? No, never. It was Caroline J from Tambunan, Sabah, Malaysia. And the best quotation,
it's very interesting.
Muhammad Azri bin Azhar, Kelumpur Embun Emas A, Jalan 15/56, Kuala Lumpur. This is the best quotation for the week. If you stop every time a dog barks, your road will never end. I don't stop, I run away.
Is it a Malay proverb? No.
Okay. Thank you so much for coming, gentlemen.
Thank you, Michael.
Thank you so much.
Thank you.
Okay. Stay around because we're going to talk to the football ladies. Yeah.
Yeah, sure.
Or you want to meet them afterwards?
Yeah, both.
Okay, we'll take a break. When we come back, we'll continue our discussion on soccer. Hari ini kita akan berbincang tentang apa? Nak tunjuk buku? Ini buku ya. Ini buku ya.
This is buku.
Ini dia punya buku dia. No failure, only success. Delayed. Okay, terima kasih banyak. Kita akan bincang tentang
MPH store or the major bookstore.
Okay. Kita akan kembali, kita bincang soal Ecuador tadi. Tadi kita talk about Ecuador. You been to Ecuador? No, yeah.
No, chill.
Okay.
Hi there, welcome to this very first episode of my show, Mr. 101. And with this brand new series, I'll be bringing you all around Singapore to learn how to do 101 things, like how to dress for that special occasion, how to make friends, cook for yourself, keep fit, things to look out for when buying a new car, even how to host your own TV program, maybe how to be a superhero. Well, maybe not. Yes, so do sit back, relax and enjoy. But don't forget to take notes, as I'll be showing you how to do all this and much, much more with me, Mr. 101, the 101 way. Many of you have been to parties, but how many times have you been left alone by a friend who walks off to talk to people that he knows, leaving you with a room full of strangers and people you don't know? And for the rest of the evening, you find yourself pretending to be preoccupied with your handphone, sampling all the drinks at the counter, or simply eyeing the girl you really want to meet for the whole night, but you're unable to move a muscle. Well, I have to admit, I've been there, and these situations, they are a little tricky to overcome. Of course, you could head down to the nearest bookstore and look for self-help books. But come on, there's no better way to make friends than to learn from me, Mr. 101. Now, what better way to meet new friends than first introducing one to you? This is Michael Lum, he's a social relations consultant. Now, Michael, we all know some basic points about making friends, like keeping a smile, body language. There's some things in grooming that we should pay attention to as well.
People form the first impression of you during the first 8 seconds. So it is very important for you to dress appropriately for the right occasion, display the right body language, and look generally good overall. You have to dress appropriately for the right occasion. And dressing well increases your self-esteem, increases your self-confidence, and you are there to make a conversation.
When you first step into the party, it's easy to feel intimidated by the number of new faces you'll see.
But if you take your time to scan the room first before approaching anyone, you just might find someone friendly enough from the different types of body language you'll see.
It is very important to display the right body posture at a social function. For example, if a guy stands like this, then people will perceive him to be very close and guests will not dare to approach him. Okay, because he's close, he's not inviting any new friends. Whereas if a person is open his arms, he is in the open position, he's in the receptive position, and he's inviting guests to come and talk to him.
While you may want to challenge yourself to try approaching someone with a closed body language, it's easier to break the ice and approach someone who's open and friendly.
Now, is it possible that some like to be left alone?
No. No one likes to be alone in a social gathering or social event. Most people like to be in a group. Now, women in particular like men to approach them. Okay, so it is good for a woman not to remain in a clique, but to break up so that you give an opportunity for men to approach you. It is very hard to break into the group, especially for a woman. So it is appropriate for a man to approach a lady when the lady get up to the ladies or to get some food.
As you approach anyone, take a step forward and extend your handshake, maintain eye contact and offer your greeting.
Once you exchange greetings, keep that conversation going with some chit-chat or banter. That's a lot you can say.
There are various ways you can start a conversation. Okay, for example, you can talk about the venue, the food, the drink, and to further the conversation, you can praise somebody. Okay, praise their dressing, praise the way they look.
But when you sense that the other party is not responding, it could be the subject of your conversation.
So quickly change the subject to something else, so simply ask her about her hobbies. But Michael, there are some things that you should avoid.
In a conversation, you should try not to be too loud or too aggressive or too arrogant. You know, people will be put off by you. And in a conversation, try to avoid sensitive topics like clothing, makeup, and behavior.
Yeah, I could color your hair like mine. Is that a pimple? Right, there are nicer ways to turn people off or end your conversation. And speaking of that, if you need to leave, just do it nicely. Shake hands, say keep in touch, nice to meet you.
Keep the conversation going to an interesting level. And then you can ask for the number, okay, or ask for a name card. And the best way of asking for a name card is to give your own name card first. And then you say, this is my name card, can I have yours, please?
Although the points presented in making friends may seem like common knowledge, we sometimes tend to forget that the easiest way to break the ice is to smile, be polite, and be yourself.